Brother Greg Flegel, would you open our service in prayer, sir?
Lord, we're so thankful that you be in your house today. We're so thankful that we come to worship you and sing praise to you.
Yes.
Lord, I just pray you be with Pastor as he brings forth the word of God. And Lord, I pray if there be anyone here who knows not Christ as Lord, Savior, and King, Lord, I pray that today could be the day of their salvation.
Yes.
In Jesus' most wonderful and precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Again, we welcome you to the service this morning. It is a real blessing to see each one of you here this wonderful Lord's Day. Let me quickly mention some of the announcements that are in your bulletin this morning. Cantata rehearsal, drama and choir. So if you're a part of the cantata, we'll be here tonight at 4:30 right in here for our rehearsal and our practice time together. I hope you're praying for the cantata. Hope you're inviting folks to come out. It is next Sunday, believe it or not. And also, of course, we're going to have our Christmas dinner. If you have not signed up for that, please do so. There's a sign-up sheet on the little welcome desk in the foyer there, but it's always a delightful time together, a time we look forward to. And again, it's always a good outreach. Some folks will come out to a cantata that would not otherwise come out for a regular service. So invite your friends and neighbors, families, co-workers, friends, anyone that you think might have an interest in coming. Then, of course, our evening service at 6 o'clock. Deacons, we have a meeting tomorrow evening at 6:30 right here, so keep that in mind. And then Wednesday evening, we'll be back here for prayer meeting. We have begun a new series called Build Below the Baseline, and it's dealing with the foundational elements that need to be present in our life if our life is to stand the test of time. So that's proving to be a blessing as we study God's Word together. Hope you can join us for that. We have our Bible study and then a season of prayer together. Of course, our youth ministry, CIA, which is kindergarten through sixth grade, and our 7th through 12th grade junior and senior high youth group, meeting Wednesday night at 7 o'clock as well. I already mentioned that first item there under upcoming events, but again, we look forward to that special time together. Christmas cards for the soldiers are due tonight, so if you could get those turned in tonight, we would greatly appreciate that. And this is the last chance. This morning is the last chance to sign up for our cookie fundraiser to help our young people as they prepare to go to Uruguay to work with the Protos next summer. Giving envelopes are in the foyer on the welcome, I think on a table maybe over here on to your right as you go out. Christmas card display board is also back there. And then, as I mentioned, last chance to sign up for the Cantata Fellowship dinner. Lots of announcements, lots of good things going on. We look forward to the Lord's blessing. Okay, the choir is going to come and share a special with us in song at this time.
Thank you. 217 as we continue singing with our offertory hymn this morning. 217, of the little town of Bethlehem. Remain seated, sing the first, second, and the fourth for our offertory hymn.
Missionaries around the world, and that your will be done in all of our lives. In Jesus' precious name we pray.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. 196, as we continue singing this morning, 196. Angels We Have Heard on High. We'll stand together, sing all four verses. 196.
Live on earth with men, but why this sword man there mocking with thorns upon his brow. Who is this one deserves such cruelty? One suspended on yonder rugged cross, the object of such shame and blasphemy. He's Emmanuel, the God of all the ages, come in human flesh to bleed and die for me. Though he was God, yet he was pleased to live on.
Thank you so much, ladies. Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Take your Bibles to Luke chapter 1, if you will, please. Luke chapter 1. You know, the world laughs at the thought of the virgin birth of Jesus Christ. And the world looks at it as some type of fairy tale or some type of myth. Satan hates it because he knows that it is foundational to Christianity, that our Lord was the God-man. His humanity and his deity are both wrapped up in the virgin birth of Christ. So it's a doctrine, it's a truth that the world laughs at, that Satan hates. But I guess worse than all of that is the fact that many who name the name of Christ downplay it. And that's sad. Because I want to show you this morning that the virgin birth of Jesus Christ is absolutely indispensable when it comes to our salvation. Our salvation depends on it. In other words, it's not something we would call incidental. It's not an incidental truth in the Bible. It's not an incidental doctrine. In the Bible, it is a fundamental doctrine. In fact, it is a foundational doctrine, because if you take it away, the entire foundation of Christianity collapses. Everything crumbles, and I'm going to show you why this morning. We're going to talk first of all about the miracle of his birth. And when we come to Luke chapter 1, the angel announces to Mary that she's going to be with child. She's going to have a baby. Now, Mary is a virgin. She is espoused, engaged, although espousal means much more than engagement, but she is espoused to a man named Joseph, but they're not yet married. And she has never had any type of physical relations with a man. And so she asks a very pertinent question. She says in verse 34, "Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee." Now, folks say, well, what does that mean? Well, let me tell you very simply. God's Spirit activates and creates by the Word of God. It's just that simple. It's not hard to understand. It's very easy. The Holy Spirit activates and creates by the Word of God. That's how it's going to be. Just simply by the Word of God. The same way God spoke the world into existence. That's how it's going to be. It's not hard because we're talking about God. The Holy Spirit shall come upon thee, and the power, you see, of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Did you note it said that holy thing? Holy. Which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. For, verse 37, for with God nothing shall be impossible. Now right there's the answer to the mystery of the virgin birth. It's right there. He tells us about the virgin birth, and then he gives us the answer to the mystery of the virgin birth. And he says to Mary, it's not a mystery. Nothing is impossible with God. And listen, that's all we need to understand. And folks who have trouble with the virgin birth of Christ, they have trouble with this verse. They just don't believe this simple truth. Nothing's impossible with God. With God, all things are possible. It's just that simple. And Mary said, verse 38, behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And that should always be our attitude, shouldn't it? When the Lord reveals his will to us through his word, Lord, have thine own way. Thy will be done. And the angel departed from her. Now, some folks say, well, I just don't understand how this could be. How could it possibly be? Well, let me just say very simply, it doesn't depend on whether you and I understand it or not. In fact, it makes absolutely no difference whether you and I understand it or not. I don't understand how a brown cow can eat green grass and give us white milk that's churned into yellow butter. But it happens. All right, so it's the truth does not depend on whether you and I understand it or not. Mary asked the angel, she said, well, how shall this be? The angel gave her the answer. The angel said, with God, nothing shall be impossible. Now listen, always remember this. You and I make a grave mistake when we think that God is bound by the same laws and limitations that we are. Folks, God created the laws. And that means he is Lord and master of those laws. That means that he can supersede those laws anytime he wants to. Can I just put it very simply? God can do anything he pleases to do. It's just that simple. And folks, by the way, I have no trouble, honestly, absolutely no trouble believing in the virgin birth because I believe in creation. God spoke everything we see, the universe, God spoke into existence. If you believe Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, the first verse of the Bible, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, you will not have any trouble with any other miracle in the Bible. Many of you know, I think one of the greatest preachers who ever lived was Oliver B. Green, Dr. Oliver B. Green. And his headquarters was close to where I grew up and very close to where I went to Bible college. In fact, he was a member of the church where I went to Bible college. His pastor taught me in Bible college. So it was, I knew all about Oliver B. Green. His library's about as big as this sanctuary. I've never seen anything like it. Anyway, I'm getting sidetracked. Oliver B. Green read Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1 and then wrote in the margin of his Bible, "And I believe the rest." That's it. "And I believe the rest." Remember now, God created the first man without a mother and without a father. From clay that he created from nothing. So I have no trouble at all believing this. So don't worry if you can't explain all the details of the virgin birth. All you need to know and understand is what the angel told Mary when she didn't know and understand. "For with God nothing shall be impossible." That's all we need to know. Now Jesus said later on in chapter 18, verse 27, he said, "The things which are impossible with men are possible with God." And in Mark chapter 10, verse 27, he said, "With God all things are possible." God did it. That settles it. I mean, that's it. And I'll just say one more thing. If you have trouble believing in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, then your God is way too small. Way too small. You're not serving the God of the Bible. Because with the God of the Bible, nothing, nothing is impossible. All things are possible with him. The miracle of his birth. I want you to mark this scripture, because this scripture is paramount to what we're discussing. 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16. Did you notice it's a 3:16 in the Bible? It's interesting. 1 Timothy 3:16. "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest," that word just means revealed, made known. "God was manifest in the flesh." That is the miracle of his birth. God in the flesh, as the ladies just sang. God in flesh. God becomes flesh and dwells among us. That's it. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up to glory. Who was received up to glory? Jesus Christ. Folks, the Bible is clear about who Jesus Christ is, because it says right here, God was manifest in the flesh, and then he was received up to glory. There's no question about who Jesus Christ is. He's God. He's God manifest in the flesh. That is what the virgin birth of Jesus Christ is all about right there. I'll just remind you of John 14 and verse 8. "Philip saith unto him," Lord, he was speaking to the Lord Jesus, "show us the Father, and it sufficeth us." We'll be satisfied. "Jesus saith unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father." See, God manifest in the flesh. That's what Jesus Christ was telling Philip. Philip, I'm God manifest in the flesh. Are you really asking me, show us the Father? I've been with you all this time and you don't even recognize me? "And how sayest thou then, show us the Father?" The miracle of his birth. God manifest in the flesh. It's a miracle. Then we see the mission of his birth. Let's go forward one chapter to chapter 2. And let's begin reading in verse 8. Luke chapter 2, verse 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. Amen. A Savior, which is Christ the Lord. There he is. Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. The mission of his birth, what is it all about? Our salvation. That's how much God loves you. That's how much God loves me. What was the mission of his birth? Why did God leave glory, become man, take on human flesh? What was his mission? His mission was our salvation. And I'm going to show you that. You see, the virgin birth and the incarnation, and when I say the incarnation, that is God becoming flesh and dwelling among us. That's what I mean by that. It was absolutely necessary for our salvation. We could not have been saved any other way. Now, follow me here. God created Adam and Eve and placed them in the Garden of Eden. And he gave them dominion over the earth. And they enjoyed sweet fellowship with the Lord. They had dominion and they had fellowship. But they chose. They had free will. And they chose to do expressly what God said for them not to do. What God had forbidden them to do. They chose to do it anyway. And when they did, they forfeited that dominion. And they turned it over to Satan. That's why he is now called the prince of the power of the air. That's why he's called the god of this world. Because the dominion that God gave to Adam, Adam forfeited it, and he turned it over and he gave it to Satan when he sinned. Also, that sweet fellowship that Adam and Eve had with God was broken. And so they gave it all away. And the entire human race was infected by sin. Now, how was the dominion lost? And how was the fellowship lost? It was lost by M-A-N. It was lost by man. The only way that it could be returned and restored was by man. Only that man must be innocent, must be perfect, must be pure, and must be sinless. Now we're starting to put the pieces of the puzzle together. Why the virgin birth? Now, as you and I are here today, all of us are represented by one of two men. Okay? You are either represented this morning by Adam, or you're represented by the Lord Jesus Christ. Now here's what's important about that. Listen to what the scripture says. 1 Corinthians 15 verse 22. For as in Adam all die. In Adam all die. Even so in Christ shall all be made alive. So you want to think about something this morning. Am I in Adam or am I in Christ? Because in Adam all die, in Christ all are made alive. Now, Jesus Christ is often referred to as the last Adam. Jesus Christ, the last Adam, came to undo what that first Adam did. Well, how did he undo what the first Adam did? Well, I told you the first Adam sinned. And as a result, sin was passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. That first Adam sinned. And the problem with sin is sin carries a heavy price tag. There is a price tag affixed to sin, and it's death. Because the Bible tells us the wages of sin is death. That's the price tag affixed to sin. And that price must be paid. Our sin must be paid for. And not only that, the Bible says that in order to pay for sin, there must not only be death, there must be the shedding of blood. And it tells us without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. And the word remission there means forgiveness. And so unless there is shed blood and death, the sin cannot be paid for. Now I want you to think with me. There has to be a perfect, pure, sinless sacrifice. Blood must be shed. That sacrifice must die. Now, God is spirit. And God in spirit has no blood. God in spirit cannot bleed. But God become flesh can. Now, do you understand the virgin birth? God is a spirit. Spirit has no blood. God in spirit cannot bleed. He cannot shed blood. But God become flesh and blood can. That is what the virgin birth is all about. So again, let's recap just a little bit. Sin came by man. Adam sinned. Sin came by man. Fellowship with God was lost by man. Therefore, it must be redeemed. It must be restored by man. By man, see, because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. All right? But not just any man. It had to be a pure, perfect, sinless man. It had to be one without spot. It had to be one without blemish. It had to be one who was perfectly sinless and innocent. Now, you and I are all sons and daughters of Adam by birth. We're all sons and daughters of Adam by birth. And no son or daughter of Adam is sinless. We all have the sin nature. Here's why. Wherefore, as by one man, talking of Adam, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. And none of us would argue with that. We all know we're sinners. We all know that we've done wrong things. Now here's the point. Had the Lord Jesus Christ been born as we were, he would be a sinner as we are. Had he been born as we have been born, he would be a son of Adam, just like we are. That means he would have a sin nature. That means he would be a sinner. That means he could not be the substitute or sacrifice for anybody's sin other than his own. The only sin he could have died for would have been his own sin. And that's why the virgin birth is absolutely foundational to salvation. Because here it is. The sin nature is passed down to you through your father, not your mother, but through your father. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 21, for since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam, not in Eve, for as in Adam all die. Folks, that's why Jesus Christ had to be virgin born. He did not have an earthly father. He was not the son of Adam with a sin nature. He is the Son of God, pure, perfect, holy, spotless, and divine. That's why it's so crucial and understand. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, who is sinless and spotless and perfect. And that's why it goes on to say, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Oh, in Adam, all die. He wasn't the son of Adam. He is the Son of God. And that's why it says, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. The Savior must be truly human and totally sinless. Jesus Christ. Truly human, totally sinless. Human, that he might restore what the first human, Adam, lost. Human, that he might shed his blood. But not just any blood. Not just any blood. The blood had to be perfect blood, and pure blood, and sinless blood. In other words, it had to be the blood of God. And that's why our Savior had to be truly human, but totally sinless. Truly human, but totally sinless and divine. So, whose blood was in that little babe in the manger? Whose blood? Well, listen to the scripture. Acts chapter 20 and verse 28. Paul is talking to the Ephesian elders, and here's what he says. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God, which he, God, hath purchased with his own blood. With his own blood. You know, that blood was the blood of God. Jesus Christ is God in the flesh. Jesus Christ is God become flesh. God made flesh, and the blood in that babe was the blood of God. It was the very blood of God. 1 Timothy 3:16 again, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. God, Jehovah God of heaven, Almighty God of heaven, was manifest in the flesh. justified in the Spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world by whosoever will, received up into glory. It was the blood of God in the Christ child. Pure, perfect, innocent, spotless, divine blood. And that's why if you take away the virgin birth, you take away heaven. You take away salvation. You take away any hope. He was born the way that he was born, of a virgin, to be what he was, sinless, to do what he did, become our perfect substitutionary sacrifice on the cross that you and I could be born again. That's the mission of his birth. That's the mission of his birth. He was born of a virgin that you and I could be born again. Truly human, totally sinless. See, God's plan is perfect. And of course, it could be nothing less than perfect. We're dealing with God. Had he not been born of a virgin, he would be a son of Adam, just like you and I are sons and daughters of Adam, and he could not have saved any of us. Mendel was famous for his work in genetics. And he wrote different genetic laws. But his law of genetics says this: every individual is the sum total of the characteristics, recessive or dominant, in its two progenitors or its two parents. Let me just put that in my language, if I could. I'm having a hard time understanding that one. You and I are the sum total of our parents. That's what he was saying there. We are the sum total of the genetic characteristics of our parents. Now, if you understand that, you're understanding the necessity of the virgin birth. Okay? Because we're the sum total of the genetic characteristics of our parents. All right? Think about it now. Had our Lord Jesus Christ been born only of deity, God plus God, then yes, absolutely. He would be fully God, but there would be no humanity to him. And he could not restore what the first human lost. And he couldn't shed blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. There is no forgiveness. And you and I would be lost. Now, suppose both of his parents had been human then. Human plus human. Now, yes, he's totally human. But now he has a sin nature. He's a sinner, and he could not redeem us. He could not save us. And so here's the truth, and the cardinal truth that we have to understand, never forget, and always hold on to and stand on. It's the truth of the Bible. His father is truly God. His mother is truly human. He is the God-man. He is God in human flesh. And that qualifies him to be our Savior. He is man such that he could restore what the first Adam lost and undo what the first Adam did. He is man such that he could shed his blood for us. But he is God, such that that sacrifice, that blood is pure and perfect and divine. such that it takes our sin away. God's plan is perfect. Who is the baby, virgin born, plain, straight, God manifest in the flesh? That's who he is. God become flesh to dwell among us. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. He is the one qualified. He is the only one qualified to become our perfect substitute, our perfect sacrifice on that cross. And he did it. He did it when he went to that old rugged cross and hung there and willingly and freely gave his life and shed his blood, pure, perfect, the blood of God, shed his blood, died there, was buried and rose again. He did it for us. That was the mission of his birth. You see, the mission of his birth is all wrapped up in his sacrificial death, his substitutionary death. In other words, the mission of his birth is all wrapped up in our salvation. And that just amazes me. I don't know about you. That amazes me. I mean, God, folks, God, the God of Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, who created the universe, the heaven and the earth, he stepped out of heaven and was born a virgin, and that's why the angel said, "This is good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." Why? He's the Savior of the world. The world to all people. And that's what the world needs. The world needs the Lord Jesus. Jews need Jesus. Gentiles, the rich, the poor, the young, old, all of us need the Lord Jesus Christ. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. That's the mission of his birth, to be your Savior, to be my Savior. Isaiah 53 and verse 6 is a wonderful verse. Just listen to it. It says, "All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him, laid on Christ, the iniquity of us all." We're all sinners. That's something we all share in common, sin. And the wages of sin is death. And listen, somebody must pay the wages of the sin. Now, either you're going to pay it, or you can put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and he's already paid it. But the choice is ours. The Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. But that's only effective for you if you're willing to put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ. The good news is this. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. That's what we need. A Savior. Who is he? Christ the Lord. Christ the Lord. And the good news of the Bible is this: believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. The virgin birth, truly human, born of the Virgin Mary, totally sinless, not the son of Adam, but the son of God. And because our sin is on the Lord Jesus Christ, his righteousness is on us. Those who have put their faith and trust in Christ. He's the Savior. And so we can agree with the angel. I want to tell you, that is good tidings of great joy. Amen? That is good news. It's good tidings of great joy. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness to us. Thank you for your wonderful word. Father, it's humbling. Lord, I don't even have the words to think that the mission of the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ was all for our salvation. Why should you love us so? But how thankful we are. And I pray that my response and the response of each heart here today would be to love thee in return with all of our hearts, mind, soul, strength, and might, and to serve our Savior, who is Lord, to make him Lord in our lives and to serve him as Lord all the days of our life. Father, I pray if there's one here this morning who knows not Christ, I pray you'd use your word, your Holy Spirit would take your word and so challenge and convince that heart this morning that that life would be changed, that that one would call upon Jesus Christ, casting all faith upon him, in him, upon him. And Lord, again, for each Christian, that would be faithful. Understanding your love would cause a response of love on our part. And we'll thank you and praise you, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. 228 in your hymnals. 228. What child is this? I want to tell you, God manifest in the flesh. Let's stand together as we sing.